So without any further delay, I would like to call upon stage the person himself, Mr. Abhishek Kolipey. Please give him a big round of applause.
Let's proceed. So before you tell my talk, so I just want to brief up, like, what's in for you. So what are you going to get out from the session? So that's what I'm going to discuss now. And the first one is, like, if you're a developer or an architect, you'll be understanding, okay, how to implement bulk API. And if you're a customer, you'll know, okay, how to reduce the cost of your Salesforce implementation. And if you're a business analyst, you'll understand, okay, how to produce, like, robust reports, robust analytics and stuff. If you're a product manager, you'll understand, okay, how to engage users in all of this. So that's the kind of thing you'll be learning.
So at least go through it. If you're a developer, you can understand how to implement the bulk API. If you're customers using Salesforce, you know how to reduce the cost of storage. And if you're a business analyst, you can understand how to generate robust reports and robust analytics. And if you're a product manager, you can understand how to engage your users more into Salesforce. Okay? So I'll be discussing on these terms, big data and Salesforce. So how both are related and how both go hand in hand. So this line, why need an inventory outside Salesforce? That is the thing which we are primarily discussing in this presentation. So before we go into the presentation, just some fun facts. So yeah, CRM and CMS, they're completely different. Just like pizza and a croissant. So, does everyone know what's a CMS? No, everyone knows it? Yeah, great. So, yeah, one more fun fact. So, big data and Salesforce are like evil twins. So, if you don't implement them properly, they destroy each other. So, you should implement properly to go hand in hand. So, that's the power. And, yeah, so we'll discuss, like, what is big data. So, yeah, first of all, like, how many of you are developers here? Like, pure Salesforce developers, okay? And any customers, I mean, like a business head or someone, like, who are using Salesforce? They're not many, yeah. So we're going to discuss, like, what is big data in terms of Salesforce. So big data is like structured or unstructured. But here, I'll present three attributes for big data in Salesforce. So what are the things to learn? So first thing is, what is it? What is the big data? I'm going to brief you about the three attributes. And after that, why do we need to solve this big data problem? So big data is like everywhere, across every system. And the other one is how to handle this, how to handle the big data. And the next one is, like, what's the best approach? What the solution which I'm presenting, is this the best solution? How do you customize solution for your organization? So all this comes here. So let's go into the first thing, what is big data? As we all know, like, everything is an object and everything is a record and everything is, like, related in Salesforce. So it's all structured data. So three attributes I'm presenting here. First one is the space. So typically GBs or space will be taken by Salesforce, by this data in Salesforce. So that's the big data. Okay? And records. So millions of records are there. So in one of my previous company, there are like 20 million records for accounts. So that's the kind of big data which we're dealing with here. And the other activity is growth. Like, it grows every day. Every day, like, thousands of records get added. Exponentially, it keeps on increasing. That's the big data which we're talking about. So let's go to the next one. So big data is completely related to that part, storage. And so we're going to discuss, like, why data is big in the order. So first one is, what is big data? Now, why data is big in the order? So first reason, Fortune 500 companies. So lot of Fortune 500 companies, they're, like, across the globe. So they'll keep on adding data every day. All the data will be put into Salesforce. That's one of the reason. Next one is the product inventory. Many e-commerce solutions like Groupon, Amazon, and Facebook, everyone, like, uses Salesforce for the product inventory. They keep all the product data in Salesforce. Yeah, the next one is sales management. How the sales are managed here? Like, every product is there. How do we sell? How much it's sold? this month how much it is sold, next month how much we are going to forecast that, and what was my sales like last year during Christmas time, during Boxing Day or something. So all this will be here. So that data is in Salesforce. That's a very big data. The next one is revenue management. So we have all the revenues, okay. This is sold in this region. This is the revenue which has got for us. And this is sold in this country. This product is sold this many number of times. If you give discount, this is sold this many times. All this data contributes to the big data. Yes. And the other one is analytics. If I want to predict, okay, in 2 months, how much is going to happen? So how much my sales are going to happen? That's all going to come to this point. Like, what's my analytics? So for that, we need a lot of data. And that is the big data. And yeah, this one is for developers. For techies, the bad architecting and design. If you do not architect it properly, you are screwed actually. So data will come, it will stay like that. So yeah, this one, like, this is what developers feel. I have like 99 problems, but storage ain't one. Like, okay, I have a problem. I need to improve my code coverage. I need to write visual force pages. I need to write workflows, implement process builder. But storage is not my problem. That's someone else's problem. That's the reason why data is getting big in the org. These are one of the main things. So this is why data is big in the org. So yeah, this is an example of an SME org, like a startup org. So it's like 10 users are there and they have 400 GB of data. So this company is like, okay, we got the funding, we have the money, so let's put all the data in Salesforce. We don't need any other system. Salesforce is, we got the licenses, within 1 day everything is operational, put everything in Salesforce. So that amounts to 400 GB. And this is typical organization. If you go back and look at your organization, this is what mostly it will be coming up to this. So 20 GB, like 20,400 MB or 4800 MB. So this is the 20 GB of total data. Out of that, 600 MB is like useful data. That comes to 2.93%. So what the organizations are doing that, they're keeping like all the data in Salesforce and only 3% is useful. Rest 97% just lying there. That's it. So this is the one of the examples. So yeah, this is very interesting slide. So what are the annual costs for extra data? So yeah, so does anyone know, like, in a typical organization, what's the allowed limit? What's the maximum limit of storage? How many GB is allowed per organization? Does anyone know that? 5 GB? 500 gross, and?
And that is based on the user license, like,
exactly.
So many user license you get multiplied by the...
This is the thing. So what typically many organizations have is the agreement we are giving. Keep it up to 10 GB. If you cross even 1 MB, we are going to charge for that. So we'll see the charges. This is the annual charge, $1,500 per extra 500 MB. Extra. So this is for 1,500. And so if you take 10 GB, it's like $12,000. Like annually you need to pay. So 20 GB itself, 10 plus 10. So it's like 12,000. And if you have 50 GB, it's like 48K you need to pay to Salesforce. If it's 100 GB, you need to pay 108K to Salesforce. And 400 GB, you need to pay $460,000 to Salesforce per year. This is the thing. So if their organization having like 500 GB, they must be paying this much. So that's what is happening. So that's the kind of level which you're dealing here. And I'll explain like why Salesforce is charging this much. So this is one interesting thing. And yeah, so before we go into why solving the problem, anyone has any questions? We discuss what is big data, why data is big, and what are the costs. Anyone has any questions in three things? It's a pure interactive session. We are just like brainstorming, that's it. It's not like any lecture or something. So anything you can ask. And we have goodies, right? Whoever like ask good question, they might get good goodies, I think. So that's what. Any other things? All clear? Good, right? 3 points? Okay. So we'll see, like, why do we need to solve this problem? Okay, shall we got to know. Data is big, too much data and paying extra cost. What are the reasons why you should solve this? Okay? Why should we care? As a developers, as like product managers, as a project lead, as a partner, as a customer success manager, CRM manager, why should you care? First thing is redundancy. Lot of data is similar. If you take a opportunity record, it will have like 10,000 records. Almost like 10,000 records, everything is same except one field. Only one field there will be difference. So it's like pure similar data, only little differences are there. And stagnant. Yeah, staying in for months. So let's say I want to complete payments to my client, and on the first week of every month I run my payments and I'm done. After that, I don't even care about the data. Data will come, it will stay here. We discussed, right, 97% is the stagnant data. That's what typical org. Even you can go and check your org also, like close to 80% will be stagnant data. And performance, yeah. So whatever system we develop, if the users are not using that, there's no point. If you're taking 2 minutes to run a simple SQL query, you are done. Nobody will use the system. Everyone will say, I don't want this. That's it. So, everyone knows that batches we have to write. If you cross 50,000 limit, batches. So if data is big, you need to keep on writing batches and generate reports. Everything will take, okay, click the button, wait for like 5 minutes or 10 minutes. Nothing will happen. So that's it will impact the performance. And the cost we discussed, unnecessary cost. Yeah, and the complexity. Users will come to the system. See, mostly sales users, right? They take their iPad, they go to the lead, they just generate the report. Okay, report is taking 5 minutes. I'm done. I don't want to use the Salesforce. That's how Salesforce is losing customers actually. If you have the proper, very less complex systems, Salesforce, okay, this is the system I should use, not any other system. It all depends on the end users. And the functionality. Use Salesforce. I mean, it's not properly used actually. You cannot take an Android phone and say, I need to make everything with it. Like, you cannot say, okay, I need to write code in it, I need to do all the things of a laptop, I need to watch TV in it. Everything you can't do with a small phone. So it's like that. You're taking Salesforce, you're using it for everything. So that's the mistake which everyone is doing here. And yeah, what's the purpose of Salesforce? So, yes. So typically people use it for CRM and ERP. Mostly it will be in the four wings like sales, marketing, operations and customer service. This is the CRM part which Salesforce is built for. In the year 2000, I mean all these people, Mark Benioff and all the founders, they built it only for CRM functionalities. It's getting for ERP functionalities as well. Okay? 17 years it didn't become a $1 billion company just out of nowhere. They have the focus, they have the mission. Okay, my CRM, it is only for CRM. We are not targeting everything. So that's the thing. And very minimal is the CMS, content management system. Salesforce is not something where you put your invoices or something. And this is the worst thing. Storage system. People upload everything. Okay, whatever is in my drive, upload it. Whatever is in my phone, upload it. Everything into Salesforce. This is the mistake which everyone does. So this very rare usage. So use what Salesforce is built for. This is the baseline of this entire presentation. Use what Salesforce is built for. Everything will be fine. Like use it only for CRM functionalities, not for storage. So you will reduce a lot of problems. So that's the purpose. Yeah. So if you take this circles, right? This is the entire data in the org, and the users are only using this kind of data, the intersection. And third party apps are interacting only with this part of data. Rest everything is useless. I told, right, 3% is the only useful data. Rest 97%, they're just lying there. That's what every org is happening. So, yeah. Now, we'll go into the solution. How to bring the solution before that? So, before we discuss the solution, we'll discuss, okay, like, what are the benefits of the solution? So any doubts still here? Why should we solve the problem? I discussed like what is big data, why data is big, and why should we solve the problem. Everything is clear? If you don't solve the problem, you are going to be screwed, that's it. So many Salesforce is like they have it in their customer agreement, it seems. If you cross 10 GB, we are going to charge you. They're charging hell lot of money because they don't want anyone of us to use it as a storage system. They want it to be used for CRM. That's why Salesforce is doing that. All this lightning, all this AI, everything came up. This is because Salesforce is focusing on CRM, not on storage. That's the thing. Okay, so we'll discuss what are the impacts. If you implement the solution, it will be best uses. System will be properly used. And high performance and response times. Your queries, your batches, everything, your reporting, everything is super fast. And no worries about inflow. You can put whatever data you want. Nobody even cares. Just put it out, solution will take it outside. So that's the thing. And cost saving. You save like a lot of cost. You can reinvest the cost at any other point. And it's like completely user friendly. Your users will be mostly using the system. Like everyone is engaged. Okay, if I go, okay, Salesforce is the one I should log in right now. Every sales guy will use that. Every marketing guy will use that. So this is the kind of user friendliness which will get here. And auditing. The system is completely audited. So every data is completely audited outside. Nobody is going to touch that. So it's completely safe. So we discuss how it's going to impact Salesforce. We'll discuss, can you please go out and talk? Please, bahar jaake baat karna. Yeah. So, sorry for that, yeah. So, what's the impact on big data? We have a lot of data here. So, what's going to happen is, it's maintained as an inventory. So, if you take, they're like, okay, 6 months back, what happened to my data? It's like, okay, completely preserved outside. No one is deleting the data. And you can build a lot of apps on top of that. You can build any integrations, you can build any YouTube, Android, Graph, any apps you can build on top of that. And history, yeah, this is one major thing. Okay, so a quick question, so for how many months does Salesforce keep the data and recycle it? Yeah?
30 days, I guess. 15 days,
okay.
15?
There is an algorithm which runs in the back end and then it wipes out the data and then recycle.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like 15 days. So you can get it from the recycle bin, close to 1 month. But if you want to get it in the next 6 months, you have to pay hell lot to Salesforce. My data has been deleted, please retrieve it me back. It's going to ask a lot. Yeah, please.
Is it $10,000 in terms of cost, I guess?
Exactly. I think it's too much. They are like, forget about the data or pay us that much. So that's the thing. It's like, if you're smart enough, you can beat Salesforce. Or else they're going to charge you for everything. So that's the thing. Yeah, so the data will be stored outside. If you want to know, okay, what's my data like 2 years back? It will be completely safe. Nobody's going to touch that. Yes, and a lot of third-party integration. You can integrate with Heroku, you can integrate with QuickBooks, Microsoft, and Oracle. Anyone work with Oracle and Salesforce integrations? No? Yeah, very rare it will happen, so that's the thing. Yeah. So anyways, it's the third party integrations. Okay? And any doubts in these two slides? All good? Yeah? Okay, let's go to the solution. It's simple. You need to know only three things for the solution. Bulk API. It's simple, hitting the API, getting the data. In bulks. Any programming language, you can use Java as well. I'm using Java because many of the Salesforce developers know Java because FX is similar to that. And you can use PHP, you can use Python, you can use anything which you want. And any data source, like Postgres database I'm using, you can use simple files, you can use MongoDB, you can use anything. Okay? So let's go into the high level. So this is the high level solution. This is my Salesforce org, and that's the database outside system. This entire yellow part is written in Java. This is where the bulk API hits the Salesforce, gets the metadata and pushes the metadata. This is where bulk API using Java gets the data and pushes the data. So this is the simple three-step procedure. Get the metadata, push it.
get the data and push it. That's it. Nothing much. We are discussing very high level things here. Okay? And the next thing, we'll go step by step. Yeah, please.
So I'm asking like suggesting to use similar kind of data. So like you talked about MongoDB or not. MongoDB has more SQL database where it stores data in the graphical format or JSON format.
Exactly.
So in that case, if you want to use that database to store Salesforce data, you have to do some transformation in between to store that data, convert it into JSON format and so on.
Exactly, yeah. So, what's your name, please?
Anubhav.
Anubhav, yeah. So, Anubhav's question, I'll just come back to you. So, Anubhav's question is okay, if you want to use some other database like Mongo or NoSQL or something, you need to do a lot of transformation there. So, that's his question. Yes, so I'm presenting the simplest form. So, it all depends on the requirements. So, when we come to that part, I'll discuss more on that. So, it's like if you want to use only Mongo, obviously, you need to go transformations. If you don't want it, the simplest format, it all comes up to your requirements. Do I need to get it in JSON format or do I need to run simple SQL queries? It comes up to the final requirement. That's the thing. Okay? We'll discuss more. I had a slide on that.
Okay. How are you solving the problem?
In one database, you are keeping the value and calling one API.
You are keeping the database at two places.
Okay, and your good name, please? Amnish Shukla. So, Amnish question is, here he was thinking like that and put it back. It's like a snapshot. Like a history snapshot you have, put it back whenever you want and put it outside. In that way, you're saving the cost, you're saving like lot of load, performance, and all these things. So, that's like putting it outside. Okay? Here we are discussing mostly of putting it outside. Okay?
Yeah,
reverse is also possible. Yeah. We'll come back to that. Yeah. You have anything?
I'm just saying why to push it back. Like I can expose it as a web service and then show it as on the S object.
Okay, yeah. That's correct. But it's simple actually. So what some people are okay, I have some logics or maybe if I want to run Einstein on the data. So it's like simply get it back, put it out. So or else we can do yours also, web service also possible. Getting back and putting it out, that's obviously I'm going to talk about web services. That's the point.
So can we run Einstein on that data and we are putting that data outside?
I mean, you can easily do that. Okay, so this is one question which I get every time about Einstein, okay? So here, does anyone know what too much, I mean, close to $3,000 I was thinking. So they keep changing that. So you, if you don't have the solution, you need to pay for Einstein, you need to pay like some $20,000 extra for the storage, you need to have everything there. But if you have this solution, your data will be outside, whenever you want, get it back, run Einstein, put it back outside. Because Einstein you won't be running like 24/7, right? Only once in a while for recommendations for analytics will be running. So that's the reason where we need to use that. So it all depends. It comes up to your requirement, your business. This is the high-level solution.
Related to this area, but my main concern is like one of the strong point of Salesforce is security, right?
Yes.
Now, to save the cost, we are compromising our security by putting data somewhere else. Who will take the responsibility of the lowering down the security? I see in the diagram, Salesforce is there, data is there, and data is all about security, right?
Exactly.
So, how much Salesforce is kind of adverting this thing to do this? Are they encouraging it or are they discouraging it?
Yes.
Can you get my question?
I got my question. It's like about the data, putting everything outside, then why putting it outside of the firewall? Like you're exposing it to all the hackers.
That's right.
Yeah.
But obviously, I am
putting everything outside, then why putting it outside of the firewall? Like you're exposing it to all the hackers.
That's right.
Yeah.
But obviously, yeah, I am.
So there's a trade-off always. So if you want cost, if you want like good performance, if you want like good user engagement, and if you want like security, everything won't happen. I mean, if you had written a batch or governance, right? For governor limits, we need to compromise on a lot. So the same thing. And here we might need to compromise on security. But again, it comes to the question. Is your data, I mean, if your data is like 1 GB data is getting added every day, how much security you want for that? If let's say if it's a financial data, it shouldn't be more than MB. I'm talking about GB of data. So typically GBs of data won't be, it's like a public data sort of, like analytics data like that.
What happens
usually
the security problem?
Yeah.
It's like when you are having a lot of data, that means you are collecting garbage. And from the garbage only, these hackers take out your key things. When your data is small, you yourself will manage.
Exactly.
When your data is becoming big data, from there your data security vulnerability will come.
Exactly. That's true, but see, most of the that's the kind of big data you're having, where if you expose it outside and the hackers are going to screw you up, I mean, that's really not the data which you should put outside. Here, mostly we're talking, which is like, okay, security can be little reduced, not say compromised, little reduced. And I'm talking about the databases which have equal security of the same thing. Okay, yeah, please.
I'll show this diagram to try this saving the cost from the Salesforce storage, you are putting data outside.
Exactly.
In the initial work, a few slides you mentioned that we are not controlling the inflow of the data.
Huh?
If we can keep the similar architecture at the inflow level, you only store the data which is relevant in the Salesforce and then everything move out, right? I mean, which is not even required. Maybe we can solve over there and not worry about security probably. I mean, maybe because it's not that important. And then at the same time, doing this creates not a management cost. We are seeing data is one level.
Exactly.
Creating the application, top of the APIs that we are talking about to bring down the data. You need to spend time, and time is cost.
True, that's true. Okay, so it already you are bringing the data. Let's take a typical example of this case. So it's all the payment information is listed. You have leads. Okay, when YouTube is there and you need to get the payment information by hitting the APIs, you need to compute, okay, to this lead I need to pay this much. This lead I need to pay this much. So for getting the data, Salesforce, as he told, right, as you also told, security is one thing. And I wrote my algorithm here. And I have implemented a system here so that I got the data, I computed, now I can put it outside. My payments are done. I'm putting it outside. So again, this is one case. If this case is like, okay, if we can stop it in the inflow also, that's fine. So all the things are like, okay, either you need to compromise on inflow or outflow. It's like a sacrificial solution. You need to compromise on one of that. Everything won't come, for sure. Okay? Yes, please.
Which every organization needs today. What you have mentioned about and what Salesforce and Oracle claims or any other organization claims, they always try to push their case that to have the secure data, you cannot put the data outside. That's one side of the story. Another side of the story is that given a situation, if the organizations are not ready to invest so much, because when they see per GB X dollar cost, they get goosebumps. That is a normal. Then in that case, put the data out. That's point number two. Point number three, coming to your point, which data should be out, which not, that's again a strategic call, because a sales data is important for sales, service for service, and operations for operations.
Exactly.
So that is the call which an organization.
Yeah, I wrote all of this in the last we completed that.
No, I'm so sorry.
Yeah, it's okay. Yeah. So by the way, he's my partner actually, he just talks like that. So yeah, by the way, so we'll go more. This is the inventory which I'm talking about, data source. Okay? So here we are using Postgres, and it's a simple system for storing data, and mostly people use database. Anyone knows what's S3? Yeah, storage system. It's simple. Instead of writing into databases, write in files, store it out. I'm gonna show the cost of S3. It will be amazing. So that's one thing. Postgres. Now let's see the structure. Okay. This is the mapping which I'm following here. Every object is a table. As you can see here, it's not visible. Account underscore SFTC. Account object is mapped to account table. And obviously the next one, field is a column. Every field is a column here. Like billing state, billing address, shipping address, everything is a column here. Okay. And the type. This can be customized, text, bar, cap, everything. So it's a simple mapping. Take an object, create a table. Take a field, create a column. take a type of data like currency, geolocation, anything, map it here. That's it. That's a simple database. Right? And yeah, language is Java. So it's a jar. A simple jar is a simple program which keeps running or connecting to the org. That is the program which will get the data and push the data. Okay? Using bulk API fetching and scheduled like daily or weekly or monthly. It is scheduled based on the frequency. Okay? And so this is a simple example of a jar. Keep your jar running, it will connect to the Salesforce, pull the data and push it into the database. Simple three-step manner. Okay? Yeah. So again here the deleting is up to you. If you want to keep it for a few days, you can keep it out, or if you want to
storage will not
deleting that, but some will say like okay, I'll delete it maybe after some time. So separate batch process will be there for that. So it depends on your implementation. Okay? So anyone knows what is R? R programming language. Alright? It's pure for data science. So even R has libraries which connect to bulk API. So every programming language, if you know PHP, if you know CSS JavaScript, sorry not CSS, JavaScript also, it connects to Salesforce. Everything has a library here. Okay? And we'll talk about the steps. Yeah. First thing is connection. You can see the code here. It's all libraries, they're built-in functions. Connection.set, password set, authorization endpoint, compression, strings, everything. Open a bulk API connection using simple Java functions, and that's it. You need security token and password. Your connection is done. That's the first step. Okay, yeah, by the way, so the security token password you need to encrypt and put it there. That's a simple thing, you need to find it out. Okay. Yes, for getting the metadata, what we'll be doing is, I'm scheduling my program daily. Every day, many objects can get added, many can get deleted, many fields can get added, deleted or modified. Everything I can get to know only by one call, that is the describe call. Using describe, you can get to know every information. What are my objects which are added? What are my fields which are modified? Fields which are deleted or changed? All these things I can get to know. And find out what are the metadata changes. It's simple here. Describe global object results. Describe global object results. So all these things. Get all the objects, get all the fields which are added or modified, and do your operation. 2.1. Now the next step. Pushing the data. It's simple. We discussed, right? Object is a table. So if you find a new object, create a new table. If you find a modification to an object, alter the table. And if you find a new field, just make an alter command. Here, right? Alter table, change the column, add column or drop column or create table. Simple database operations. That's it. That's for metadata. Okay? So two steps. Get the data using security token and password, and find out metadata changes. Make the relevant changes in the database. Okay?
Excuse me.
Yes, please.
Geolocation field type. It contains two data, latitude and longitude values.
Yes. So for that, you need to encrypt both the data or something, like at the rate or comma separator. Like it's all your implementation. So add a separator, append both of them, and store it up. Okay? Question till here. Good. Okay, 2.3. And the data. Okay, now is the important thing, the critical step of like for every developer, getting the data. Simple things are, use the last modified time. Okay, so one modified timestamp and last modified timestamp. System modified timestamp and last modified timestamp. Didn't anyone get in the interviews? This one.
Can we look at time zone or
something? Yeah, not exactly time zone. Okay, system modified in the sense, last modified, if I make it as a user, it's the last modified. System modified and last modified will be sometimes different because workflows or formulas will keep updating them. So, system modified timestamp is a back end, the true value. Most of the times it will be same only. So just remember that. Yes, and so based on the time, delta, you need to find out the delta, past 24 hours. Okay, get the data which have been added or modified using the system modified timestamp in the last 24 hours. Simple query. Okay? Yes, now is the
interesting thing. SOAP APIs. So SOAP API has WSDL. It means Web Service Definition Language. You need to have this WSDL file for opening a SOAP API connection. Okay? And it accepts only XML formats. XML, everyone knows it's all tags only. SOAP API accepts only XML formats. Okay? And it has a lot of limits on that. It's like typical limits, the governor limits keep applying. And there's a limit on number of calls as well. So you cannot like keep hitting SOAP API. Then advanced API is REST API. No WSDL, simple authentication. It accepts XML and JSONs, but still there are limits. Bulk API is like REST API without any limits. Simple, hit it off with the password, username, security token and password. Get the data, push it. How much ever you want, millions, trillions, I mean lakhs, any records. Get it out, push it. Simple. That's it, okay? And by the way, so data loader, everyone uses, right? It's built on bulk API only. So you need to understand that. Yeah, that's the thing, bulk API. That's the reason we are using bulk API. Not simple REST APIs, because it will always fail. Okay? The last step, pushing the data. It's posting the metadata first. Post the metadata changes and push the delta table wise. Okay, this table is newly added. It has 10,000 rows. Add all of them. Only 5,000 are modified. Make update operations for that. So simply get it out. And the unique key is the ID. Salesforce ID is unique. Okay, everyone knows it. What's the difference between 15 and 18 characters? Yeah, knows it. So that's the unique thing. Yeah, please. Yeah.
I was just saying, if query for the API, you get the 18-digit IDs. Normally, if you are doing that, it would be 15-digit.
Exactly. Yeah. So this is the 2.4. We'll go into one last thing. Yeah. On Salesforce, you need not even write a simple, not even one query, not even one Apex code, not even a simple field up. Nothing. You need not do anything. What you need to do in Salesforce is give the security token, whitelist. Okay, whitelist your application. You need to add it to remote site settings and whitelist the IPs or something. Or else it won't allow that one. So you need to know what you're doing here. Okay, this is step 3. And yeah, reverse engineer. This is what you are asking, right? Importing and exporting. We talked about exporting. But if I want to put it back, just reverse engineer. Simple, use web service callouts or APIs or just reverse the same things. Using Java, take from database, put it into Salesforce. That's the thing. Based on your requirement, based on your call, like as you told, strategy, so find it out, what's the best thing. Okay, we'll discuss more about that. Now, last two slides. Okay, yeah, we'll see how the costs are reduced.
I have more
query
on it.
Yes, please.
As you said that the bulk API, the REST API has no limit, and how are we overcome that?
Okay.
The bulk API.
Yeah, so, REST API has limits on number. If you want to fetch like let's say 2 lakh records, you might need to hit it like multiple times.
Again, you run a batch. If you run a batch, 24 hours, there is a limit.
Yes. How many calls you can make?
Yes.
Yeah. See, that's what I'm telling. REST API means you can make multiple calls. Bulk API single call, it will get all the data. In the past 24 hours, you might need to make only one bulk API call per object.
But there's a 10,000 limit in bulk API
also. 10,000 calls, right?
Yeah. Limit.
Okay, record limit is 10,000. In bulk API we can get even more of that. Okay, yeah. Serializing the batches.
To overcome that, you will run the batch.
Correct.
Because the batch can go to us in 24 hours, 1 lakh batch can be run.
Yes.
Like that. So that is, so how are we to overcome all this limited when you are pulling the data from outside?
Pulling data, okay, from outside into backend.
Yeah.
Okay, I was thinking, yeah. Okay, you have here. Then you need to maybe compress all the data. Like one thing is have different API calls, as you told, right? So instead of using REST API, see again bulk API is not like the perfect solution, but comparatively better solution is the bulk API compared to REST. Because REST, right, you cannot like even insert even 5,000 records also. It will keep holding that back.
I'm not saying that it has
limit.
There is a limit to everything.
Yes, of course, yeah. But in this solution, bulk API is better because of the record limit. Here we are talking mostly on the big data, right? So, what I was thinking is that when you're talking about records, let's focus on the limits of the records only. Like, API calls we can make all the time.
So that's the reason I was thinking of Kolipey being better than REST API.
Whenever we're talking about big data, we use data.
Correct.
We are no way talking about 5,000 data for 10,000 people. We're talking about millions of data.
Exactly.
Not millions of data.
Correct.
At that time, limitations are coming. At a practical situation when we are working on it.
Yes. So, but still, I mean, still again the point comes is why are you using REST API for that? Why can't you use Kolipey which has little more flexibility on the records, size of records? So maybe that one. Or maybe we'll discuss it more, I think. So, yeah. Okay, almost done. Talking about, this is where you need to, EC2 is a server where you need to run your Java program. The jar, it will keep connecting to the org. So that's the annual cost. $700 is the annual cost for the server. Okay. Yes, and $0.25, that's the annual cost for 10 extra GB in S3. If you store it in files, that's the $0.25 you need to pay to Amazon S3,
so
for the extra 10 GB. Okay, and for developing the jar, it's like $1,000, only for one time development. Okay, and after that, so this is the cost which are coming back, $1,600, $1,700 and $1,725. And $1,800. So we'll see the savings here. 10K, 47K, 107K, and 460K. So these are the savings which you are doing here. So I worked on this one in my previous company, 50 GB wala. So $47 you're able to save for that. And if you implement it more, you can save even $100,000 as well. So it all depends on your context, on the requirement, what you're going to do. So that's the thing. Yeah, is this the best approach? So this is what everyone is asking. Is this the correct approach? So my answer is yes, in only in your context. Based on your context, based on your requirement, you need to keep modifying the solution. So things to consider. What's the type of data? Is it like a product data? Is it like a finance data? Is it like a operation data? That's the thing you need to consider. Then next one, size of data. How much size? Is it like in GBs or billions of records or TBs or only like few MB? And the next one, frequency of inflow. How frequently are you putting the data into R? And the last attribute, usage. How are we going to use the data? Is it only one day per month? Is it only like 1 hour per like 2 months? Or every day you're using 1 hour? How much is that? Based on these four attributes, you need to build your solution. So all of the things which people have shared, right, it all comes to these 4 points. What's the type? What's the size? How frequently you're getting? How are you using the data? All these things come up here. Okay? The last slide. Last one only, 2 minutes. Yeah. So, yeah. While implementing for developers, the schedule frequency. How frequently you want to schedule? Like, is it like daily? Or is it like you want to schedule once per every month? Or something? So, as you are telling, right, so we have the calls also. So, based on the calls and the type of data, you need to see, okay, if you want to schedule per week, or per every day or per once in a month. So all these things. And programming language, whichever you are comfortable. If you want to run analytics or data science program, use R. And if you want to run Python, data science, more algorithms, use Python, which will connect to Salesforce. Okay? And data source type, the type of data source. Is it like a MongoDB or is it like PostgreSQL or simple S3 files or just dump it in CSVs. What's the data source type? Okay? And structure. That's also like, are we using JSONs, are we using XML, CSVs? All these things we need to use it here. So these are the things you need to keep in mind. Okay? Oh yeah, that's it. So these are the things. So any questions I can take for 2 or 3 minutes? Any other things?
So is this...
Yeah, so my problem which I directed is, get the data from YouTube, compute the payments and forget about it. So here we are like having huge amount of cost and running one simple query is taking a lot of time. So for our case, this solution is the best. We saved on cost, we saved on performance, users are using that, our data is completely archived. So we got everything. So most of the cases you might not get everything. So few of them you might get it. Yeah.
But maybe
yeah?
We can use set up some process in Salesforce with it. So that we can avoid creating those kind of data.
Yes.
Or we can set up a process where we can delete those data
regularly,
which is not required.
Exactly.
Time, so.
Yeah, if you are having that one, that's fine, but I'm pretty sure there will be a lot of redundant data. Useful data is very less percentage. Okay, any other questions?
Before,
yeah, please.
Before, what are the different approaches you reviewed before you selecting it?
Okay, so first thing is about the kind of database. You have the relationship. We choose it because we have a lot of relations. So, our, we first start off with going by a JSON. JSON, like MongoDB and stuff. And we even implemented using Heroku as well. Heroku and Hadoop, yeah. We wanted an analytics, so we pull the data, we had Hadoop APIs, get it, dump it, and do it all. But that didn't solve our problem quite much. We need to go into much of an extra thing. Ours is plain simple. So we tried Hadoop one thing, JSONs we tried, database structures, and yeah, that's it. That's the most of things. That's one that contextually we feel this is better. So I gave like 5-6 solution. I mean 5-6 points. Only 3-4 points might come up to give a solution. But some other solution only 2 or 3 might come up. So this is like the major things. Okay?
Thank you.
Any other things?